Shonik was here, though. He was in the corner and like had his shoes off, just like he had his toes out, like rubbing his feet.
Oh yeah, I'm not a toes out guy. That's weird.
Yeah, he was super comfy on that pod.
What movie did he do?
He's a comfy guy.
The Mask.
Air Bud or something. The Mask. That's
not
funny.
Far off.
That's a good one to do. The Mask.
What made y'all choose American Psycho?
Just we together just text each other lines from it all the time, so it was just a no-brainer.
So you actually hit him up and asked him what movie to do?
I think you had already selected it, but when you told me, I was like, absolutely.
I made an executive decision.
Yeah, but he knew I would be on board with it. Yeah.
That's very American Psycho of you, the executive decision.
That's right. I'm the vice president. We're all the vice president.
Me and Nick are the CEOs of Movie Ruiners Entertainment.
Hell yeah, dude.
I don't know. That's still probably the vice president.
Yeah. I'll look like the CEO right now.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. I definitely don't.
I really appreciate the effort that this is great.
Yeah, did you dress up as Jim Carrey for Shonik's thing? Or?
No, I would never do that for Shonik.
Well, we
I had the
it.
Gold suit, though. I dressed up as the Mask in like fourth grade and won a costume contest
because
just a ridiculous yellow suit.
Right.
And I was like,
right.
You got to give it. It'd be a dick move to not at that point.
Yeah, I didn't have a lot of friends.
We just talk about the Mask for like an hour.
And it gets so many more views than Shonik's episode.
I think Jim Carrey could have been a really good Patrick Bateman, though.
Oh,
for sure.
Hell yeah.
This was probably before he was doing like serious roles, though.
Him doing the mirror routine, it would have been kind of like Truman Show when he's like looking in the mirror. Jim Carrey.
Oh yeah.
I just imagine him working out, trying to.
Yeah, I do 100 crunches a day.
There
I'm
is up a to 1,000 now.
Yeah, there's a Mask at the beginning of the show when he's putting on the. He talks about masks at the beginning of this movie.
Yeah, the facial mask.
Oh yeah.
Do you know he actually did that like routine when he was like preparing for the movie? He did the whole facial routine every morning. He said.
Well, yeah, but he also lost like 1,000 pounds to be the Machinist. So that's. That's less
not
impressive, but it's also funny to put it that way. Like the same actor, can you believe he did the whole facial routine? Well,
he's so method.
Yeah, dude, this guy goes insane with his body for every acting role that he has.
Man, that's commitment.
It was crazy to me. He was 26 when he made this movie.
Yeah, man, looks good.
They all look so young.
Look at him,
Justin Theroux.
What a cast.
Oh yeah, Josh Lucas, man, he's hilarious in this. Josh Lucas does voiceovers for Home Depot commercials now.
That's right.
That's the power of the Home Depot.
Bum, 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 bum.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
First gift we got you, Foskey.
Oh, dude.
Got you some
my
merch.
My very own Movie Ruiners t-shirt.
Oh, that's sick.
Let's fucking go, dude. Yeah, I love coming here so much.
Tour was worth it already.
This is the best. Hold
that's
on.
Awesome, man.
Let me see the back.
Yeah, you already know there's a surprise back there.
Now put it, Foskey, now put it on and murder him with an axe.
Do you like Mike Birbiglia? That's my impression of comedy Patrick Bateman.
Oh.
Yeah, all his little monologues he goes into right before he kills somebody. Mm-hmm. He's got to play him a little record, you know?
Do you like Phil Collins?
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
Then he released this, Duke.
You like Huey Lewis on the news?
They're okay.
Their early work was a little too new wave for my taste. But when sports came out in 83, I think they really came into their own, commercially and artistically.
God, I love when the girls are laughing at her, though. Like, you actually listen to Whitney Houston?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They all just make fun of him.
It's so funny if you just appreciate how much they exaggerate all the mannerisms and ridiculous things that he says.
Yeah, like just, I want to stab you to death.
Exactly.
I'm going to murder you later.
It's so ridiculous to say that.
But there's some things that are relatable, just like when you get bad service and you think those things in your head, you know?
Whoa, whoa. That's all it takes for this guy.
Bad service.
I want drinks now.
Just two bars on his phone, the first woman he sees, I want to drink your blood. It's just like, Jesus.
Just relatable stuff.
Yeah. You're not you when you're thirsty.
This is not a date movie. I did try to watch this with a girl once, and She made us turn it off when he curb stomps the dog after he kills the homeless guy.
My girlfriend did not like that.
I forgot about that part, and in retrospect, that was my bad. That was not a good pick.
Girls don't like that.
No.
What's great is that's the type of move where you're like, oh, if you're not liking this now, we need to get out of here.
For sure. It's not going to get better.
Probably not going to like the killing scenes.
Well, dude, on the flip side, I watched it with my ex, and she got it immediately and loved it. And I'm like, maybe that's also a red flag.
Yeah, I don't think there's any win. This is just not a date movie. I don't think there's winning in that, you know.
Yeah, this is one you watch alone in the dark and then text your friends about.
Look at this.
Yeah, dude.
Look at the physique.
No, he's
I can't picture Jim Carrey doing that.
Yeah, I don't know why.
Jacked Jim Carrey would be weird a little bit. Yeah, you know? Even just the
he's
physique.
Already so powerful, dude. He doesn't need.
Yeah, y'all said y'all would text some of the lines to each other. What are some of your favorite lines from this movie?
Let's see Paul Allen's YouTube clip. Usually that's what it is. Oh my God, it even has
it even has the watermark.
Yeah, if you're wondering why there's some pauses right now, it's because we're distracted by how hot Christian Bale is.
That's right. Yeah, you guys got to put this footage in the clip.
Oh, it will be in there.
Of him applying the herbal mask that he leaves on for 10 minutes while he prepares.
Can you believe he did this?
Yeah, seriously.
The depth, man.
This is the most impressive acting ever.
I would
He's
never.
Just so method, dude.
Dude, if I got built like that somehow for a role, I'd quit acting. I'd just be like, I just look like this now, and I'm gonna just live my life as a jacked dude.
Right.
I would never do another movie because I would just want to lose the body. I would eat so bad immediately and be like, this is how I'll be remembered.
There he goes, peeling it off. Yes. Apparently this scene took like 100 takes.
Oh.
Because it wouldn't come off in one piece.
Oh, dude, imagine him losing his shit on set of this movie because the mask won't come off, right?
Like the Terminator set?
Yeah, but it's because one guy keeps walking through the background like on that released, freak out that he had.
Damn it, Bruce.
I almost had it this time.
This guy keeps walking through, knocking my hand.
I want you off the fucking set, you prick. No, don't just be sorry. Think for one fucking second. The fuck are you doing? Are you professional or not?
Yes, I am.
Do I fucking walk around and rip down? No, shut the fuck up, Bruce. Do I want? No. No. Don't shut me up. Am I going to walk around and rip your fucking lights down in the middle of a scene? Then why the fuck are you walking right through? Like this in the background. What the fuck is it with you? What don't you fucking understand?
Well, the next gift I got both of you.
Oh, my God, dude.
What do you think about this?
Oh, Pale Nimbus. Thank you. This is perfect.
That's bone, actually.
Oh, my God, dude. I'm keeping this in my wallet forever.
Yes, dude. I'm going to hand this to people. Just show you. Give it back.
Well, no. All right. We
have one.
I only got one.
I only got one card.
We said it wasn't a date movie, but... If you give this to a girl, if they ask for your number, I'm gonna do that on this tour, bro. There will come a time.
I don't know, dude. They might report that to the police. If you do that. I think this guy wants to kill me. Does yours have a watermark?
No.
All right.
But it does say that I work in murders and executions. Yeah.
You didn't want to lose it, right?
Exactly.
Oh my God.
Yeah, that's his secretary, Chloe Savigny. She ended up doing like a sex tape or something, and then she got out of acting for a while. But she's in Louis. She's been back. She's in Louis. Some Louis episodes.
That's right.
Who
is she in Louis?
I think he meets her on like, she's like a librarian or something, I think.
Oh, right. And that's the scene where he asks her out and he's like, okay, I'm asking you out right now. And I know you're going to say no, but before you do.
This kind of thing is so awkward and horrible that, from your end, it must. Okay, I'm going to come out and tell you I'm asking you out. That's what I'm doing. Please don't answer yet because I know you might have a no queued up in your head already.
It's either that lady or a different one, but I know she's in some episodes for sure.
She has one of the best scenes, like the most like heartfelt scene in the whole movie where she's the only person that like talks to him like normal.
For sure.
Yeah. Right when she's like about to get murdered.
But he decides not to.
Yeah, he decides not to kill her because for whatever reason, I don't know.
Don't just look at it, eat it.
Yeah, but he doesn't say that to sweet Chloe. He says that to the nameless, faceless prostitutes that he hires.
The way he's always like correcting the way she's dressing too.
Oh yeah, very very Mad Men. Let's get some heels, let's get a shorter skirt, get to work. Yeah.
You're prettier than that.
Yeah.
It was such a, like, compliment.
Oh,
salt.
Better times. Can't talk like that anymore around the office, you know?
Don't wear that outfit again.
What? I didn't hear you.
I said, do not wear that outfit again. Wear a dress, a skirt, or something.
You don't like this, I take it.
Come on. You're prettier than that.
Thanks, Patrick.
I'm not here. And high heels. I like high heels.
These are Nick's words, not mine.
Our words.
That's right.
Yeah, man, we're all doing the podcast together, you know?
Yeah, we're all going down together.
See, now this yeah. is where Foskey shines. All of his interactions with Reese Witherspoon. Oh,
I felt this too. Foskey, just where you're like, I'm trying to listen to this song, and my supposedly fiance just keeps interrupting.
This is one of the best lines in the movie where she's like, then why do you do all this? He's like, because I want to fit in. It's so good.
My favorite is just always where he has the deer antlers on and he just looks so mad Christmas party, but he has like the silly little hat on. Have a holly jolly Christmas. Is Alan still in charge of the Fisher account?
Yeah, that's coming up. That's where they're going.
And the music's not even that good that he's listening to. He's
listening simply, to simply irresistible.
Yeah. It's just music to chop people up to.
What music do you think he'd be listening to in 2023? Because it is just like the poppiest music.
Oh, dude, yeah.
Do It'd be like, some TikTok song.
It would be that, or he would be like, do you like Jack Harlow?
Yeah, he's explaining.
Why do they sit with the goths? There's like multiple scenes where they're hanging out with like goth people. I never understood that.
Maybe it's their drug connect.
Yeah, true. They talk politics with them and shit.
I remember you saying that the goth kids always had the most sex in high school.
Very true. Everybody knows it's the tail girl, dude.
And then this is where he's explaining that like his wife is definitely cheating on him, but then he's cheating on his wife, right? Now he's smiling at her, and she's married to the gay guy.
God, he kills it in this movie, dude. He's so fucking good.
Patrick, you're sweating.
Just with that goofy-ass hair.
Where did you get that handbag?
Ooh. Where did you get that overnight bag?
Jean-Paul Gaultier.
Well, Nick, next thing we got you. Welcome back to Birmingham.
Oh, man. Yeah, yeah. This is a big deal that I'm back in town now. The streets are talking. Murphy's back to average another 12 points per game or whatever it was.
D3 athlete Nick Murphy.
That's right. Former.
How long were you at Birmingham Southern for?
2 years. I was there 2 years.
How was it?
I mean, I had a good time. I think I just, it was a little small for my taste, so I wanted to kind of just do college, you know?
Yeah.
At a certain point, because I knew I was there just to play basketball for the most part. And it was actually smaller than my high school, so at a certain point, I just kind of felt like, and it's no knock against the school, I just felt like socially, I was kind of doing high school twice.
Yeah.
So then I was like, well, I got all these friends at UGA, let me just go there. So I transferred, not for basketball or anything, I was just a student, so it was a good time.
You weren't doing stand-up at that point in time, were you?
Not at Birmingham Southern. I don't even know where I would have gone at that point. I wouldn't have known how to look up open mics or anything. Yeah, plus with the schedule, I mean, I know it's D3, but still, as a college athlete, your schedule's pretty crazy anyway, just with practice and everything. And then you got to get up at like 5 a.m. to go lift weights. So it would have been tough to be doing open mics the night before, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And then, God forbid, they get a tape of me and then they trick him and play that during the team. You know, we're supposed to be watching
film. Watch the highlights.
We're going to watch some of Nick's stand-up.
Let's see what Nick thought was so important to go do.
Just me bombing. That would have been the worst.
Were you doing comedy when you were at UGA?
At the very end, yeah. When I was a senior.
Hell yeah, dude.
Yeah. And I was shuttling between Athens and Atlanta.
How long into stand-up did we meet each other?
It was probably like 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
I didn't really talk to anybody for like 3 years.
And then he met. And then he met me.
That must have been.
You know what? I don't think that's the worst way to do it, man. Just stay the fuck out of the way. And do your jokes. You know, prove that you're worth talking to, off stage, on stage. You know.
Yeah.
At least that's how I put it on myself. Maybe that's a little too.
But that's, you had athlete brain about doing comedy.
That's right.
And I think that's what really benefited you.
I want to get picked for the team. I don't want to ask.
Exactly.
To be on the team.
Okay. Yeah. There's so many guys.
You don't ask the coach
now.
For minutes.
Yeah. No. There's so many people that complain now, but they don't even have 5 minutes. And it's just like, come on, man. Show me that you got something first before you start, you know, going on Facebook. Oh, these people aren't booking me. These people aren't blah, blah, blah. But whatever.
A tale as old as time with stand up.
Yeah, yeah. It's going to keep happening, I'm sure. This is where he's yelling at the Asian lady. because he's got obvious blood all over his sheets that he killed someone with.
So do you think everything in this movie happened, or how much of it is his imagination?
We were talking about that in the car on the way here. I don't know. I kind of think none of it really happened, and it's all just these paranoid fantasies that he has. He's clearly a paranoid schizophrenic that's unmedicated.
Than the alternative, which would be he did do it, but the satire sort of being that all the Wall Street guys look exactly the same and do all the exact same stuff, so they get confused with each other. And so that's why they never picked up that, you know, he is or is not Paul Allen or killed him or whatever. I think it's more likely that it's like a sort of like Fight Club, where he just imagined the whole thing kind of because he went so insane and just created Brad Pitt.
Yeah, and I do love how during his confession, he's crying, and then he stops crying when he goes, and I killed Paul Allen.
With an axe.
I enjoyed that.
Face.
Yeah.
I killed another girl with a chainsaw. I had to. She almost got away. And Paul Allen. I killed Paul Allen with an axe in the face. His body is dissolving in a bathtub in Hell's Kitchen.
See, it's so funny.
Yeah, that's very petty.
But there's people out there that would watch that scene and just not laugh at all. And just be like, this is horrific. I hate this. It's like, oh, I don't want to hang out with you then. This is very funny to me.
The first time I watched it, I laughed, but it was also like, you know, the tone is kind of jarring because you're trying to figure it out. You're going on a roller coaster ride.
Yeah, yeah.
And I definitely laughed and enjoyed it. But I watched it again last night. It was just laughing so loud watching it. Like, just because I already know what's going on.
I'm on the verge of tears when I realize we're not going to get a good table.
Yeah.
A wave of relief washes over
right.
you.
Yeah, that's right. To take something like that seriously is hilarious.
And even when after he kills Paul Allen, he's like, he talks about, he starts to have a panic attack because he realizes this apartment's at a better, like, oh, he has a better apartment. Yeah, it's more expensive than mine.
Clearly more expensive than mine.
I calm myself down. It's like the murder didn't freak him out.
Yeah.
No. Next thing I got you, Foskey.
Oh my God, dude. A Bam Margera tech deck.
These guys did their research on
They
us,
did
man.
A deep dive. I hope Bam's doing okay. He's probably having some meltdowns right now. And it comes with a plunger that he put on his deck. This dude. I like that this is 17 plus. I like that that says that on here. Thank God. I'm old enough. I'm allowed to.
It's a tech deck.
I'm allowed to play with this.
Yeah.
Poor 16-year-olds out there.
That's right.
What do you do with the plunger? I see the little toy plunger in there.
I'm going to stick it on your face while you're sleeping, dude.
On one of our faces?
Whatever the
this
fuck
is gonna
be he
the
wants.
Best tour ever.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're sharing a lot of rooms, Nicholas. You better watch yourself.
I got to be careful.
But the Bam Margera toy, last time you were here, you did a Bam Margera impression.
Dude, this kicks so much ass.
I was talking about how sad his life is. You're like, yeah, dude, I'm like so sad.
I'm so sad right now.
I do that impersonation to myself anytime I am like sad or in a bad mood.
Dude, I'm so sad.
It's like I'll say that and start laughing. Like, okay.
Foskey was murdering that impression for like a while. This was probably 3-4 years ago.
Oh, shit.
And then he dressed up as Bam Margera to do a set on one of the most popular shows in Atlanta at Star Bar.
Yeah.
And he like ate it. They just weren't into it.
I committed.
He committed.
I'll give myself that I committed.
But man, he flamed out on that one.
It was really bad.
Very Bam Margera true form.
Oh, yeah.
The thing is, I was so convinced because it's Star Bar, it's where all the skaters hang out. I was like, these are all skaters here. They're in their like mid-20s. Like, we all grew up with Bam. Like, they're going to know what I'm talking about. And they did for about the first minute. And then I started doing observational comedy that Bam would do.
Yeah.
And it just immediately tanked. And then my roommate at the time tried to save me. Like, he came up on stage to be like, you can slap me. And I think he meant slap him in the face. But I was just doing, like, body shots, like how he would do to Phil.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't get anything. And then the host, Animal Controls, Michael Rowland, gets back on stage after my set. And he goes, what was that? Like, you had a chance, and you fiddle-faddled. Those words still echo in my head.
Fiddle-faddle. Oh, man, we're about to see the business card scene. I don't mean to interrupt, but, oh, look at the flick.
Oh, yeah.
There it is. And he goes, is that a gram? Yeah. Oh, we have that now.
It's definitely like the Ace of Spades, the way they put it and yes. slide it over.
The little two yes. finger slide.
Yeah.
The music is always the That's most bold. Suspenseful, too, during these scenes.
Yeah. The
Pale Nimbus Romalian type.
The swish yeah, when he pulls it out at the end, the business card.
It's very cool, Bateman, but that's nothing. Yeah. Like, who's to say eggshell is cooler than bone? You know, it doesn't matter.
Not me.
I love, dude.
But
I love
his
face.
Yeah, he's yeah. like sweating a little
it
bit.
It bothers him so fucking much.
It's a nice car.
I can't believe Bryce prefers yeah.
fucking biting his thumb.
I love that font.
Then here comes the Pale Nimbus. Yep. Raise lettering. Got to raise the lettering. Look at that.
They
impressive.
All and
very nice.
Here, let's see Paul Allen's card. Here it comes. He knows it's going to push him over the edge, and he wants to see it anyway.
It's like, that's what he was thinking the whole time, too. He's like, oh, I got the excuse.
I feel like he almost wants it to push him over the edge so he has a reason to murder somebody later that night or something. Look at that. Slow motion. Oh, that's nice.
The subtle off-coloring white.
Ooh. The tasteful thickness of it. Oh, my God.
That's the serial killer eyes right there. Yeah.
It even has a watermark.
Yep.
That's best.
Yep. And then this is when the gay guy's like, Patrick, you're sweating.
Let me get you.
Yeah. He looks like a Marvel villain right here. Just,
oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I will have my revenge.
And it's literally
but
just...
it's over nothing. That's what's so funny about it.
Yeah, he's losing it over a business
card. He's going to go kill a lot of people because he didn't care for one guy's business card.
This homeless guy that he kills, too. He's like, yeah, you smell yeah. like shit. Do you even know that?
This is where we're about to turn the movie off. Actually, the date was at BSC also.
She's probably into it. Like, it starts off, it's him in his underwear. She's like, all right, I'm liking this movie.
We'd like to think. I mean, maybe. I don't know. She was probably...
Yeah. She has a morning routine. She can relate.
Yeah.
Well,
does the mask every day. Yeah.
The way that they market this movie is they said it was written by a misogynist but directed by a feminist. That was like one of the things they said to try to like make it more appealing. But clearly not feminist enough.
No. No. Plus the stomping of the dog, I think. They're just like, well, that's just unnecessary.
And
right
the dog
there.
Makes the noise like 3 or 4 times.
Yeah.
We're just like, all right, once.
He does it again to make sure.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot about yeah. this line where he asked what happened to the homeless guy. He goes, insider trading.
I'm just kidding.
I'm just kidding.
If you're so hungry, why didn't you get a job?
I lost my job.
Why? You drinking? Is that why you lost it? Insider trading? Just joking.
But then he just goes right at him. He goes, you know, you reek of shit.
Yeah, yeah. You know that, right?
You have a negative attitude. That's what's stopping you.
Yeah, one of those self-help guys. Yeah, see, the dog doesn't need any of this smoke, man. Mm-hmm. There's no need for that.
Patrick Bateman's definitely Republican. Just pull yourself up by your bootstraps.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
right.
yeah.
Which is also funny to tell a guy who's clearly down this bad to just pull yourself up by your bootstraps.
Just get a job.
At one point he goes, I just don't have anything in common with you.
Yeah. He's like, this conversation's done.
You got a negative attitude. That's what's stopping you. You got to get your act together. I'll help you.
You are so kind, Mr. You're kind.
You know how bad you smell. You reek of shit. Do you know that? Al. I'm sorry. I don't have anything in common with you.
And then instead of just walking away, he just stabs him multiple times in the stomach.
I guess he's more of a cat person,
just,
right?
Yeah, just so unnecessary.
Well, that and the ATM says, feed me a cat yeah. when he's checking his balance.
Oh, that's right. He tries to put it into the ATM.
The first time I watched it when that scene popped up, that's when you're like, wait, what is going on?
Oh, yeah, yep. That's a great line, too. Calling a homeless guy a loser.
Yeah.
That's so funny. It's like, why, man? You know what a loser you are?
Cold out here.
It's you know what a fucking loser you are?
What?
Unnecessary.
Like he's in high school or something, yeah. You know?
Know your place.
That reminds me of Always Sunny when Frank's talking about, like, this is what I like to do. I like to fill up a water balloon with piss and go to the homeless guy and be like, have a taste of the high life, you sack of shit.
He fills it with champagne. And he goes, and it just gets on his mouth. He doesn't get a taste, not even a full sip. And I just say, hey, how do you like the good life, you piece of shit?
See? And people love that show. So why do people hate this movie, you know? I guess because he brutally murders the homeless guy. They don't do that in Sunny.
At night, I ride around town in a limousine, partying, having a good time. When I'm on my way home, I pass a bum.
and take a balloon with some champagne in it, lob it out, and beat him. He only gets a little bit in his mouth. He doesn't get the whole thing, not even a full sip of it. And you say, hey, how do you like a taste of the good life, you sack of shit?
I think Dennis Reynolds is very American Psycho.
He is.
Steve Winwood and all that 80s stuff.
Actually killing people. Mm-hmm. He's got the same sociopathy.
He's a golden god, dude.
Mm-hmm. I need my tools.
Yeah.
I'm a five-star man. Oh, yeah. I like to bind. I like to be bound.
They're all going to pay the ultimate price.
Whoa. Oh. Dude, what's all that stuff you're grabbing?
Tools. Tools. This is a duct tape, zip ties, and gloves. I have to have my tools.
Well, why do you have a bunch of, like, weird tools in a hidden compartment in your car?
Fetish shit! I like to bind, I like to be bound. That's not important. Don't ask me questions. I'm not taking questions. The Golden God is not taking questions. I am the Golden God. I'm taking action. I gotta go. Whoa.
You're talking about Foskey dressing up.
Yeah.
And doing a set.
Yeah, yeah.
Next gift, we got you.
What do we have here? Let's see what we got here. Toxic. What is this? Oh, the Venom. You saw me dressed as Venom. So that's actually
This is Bane. This is what turns into Bane.
Gotcha. Okay, I did both, actually. I was Bane and Venom two different years. Yeah, the Bane one was pretty sick, actually. That worked out. Every year, that same place, Star Bar, if you dress up, they'll put you on the Halloween show.
Some people clearly are better at it than others.
Well, what I decided to do was, because all my friends wanted to dress up even though they don't do stand-up, I was like, all right, we're just going to all be different Batman villains, and we'll just go one at a time, but I'll put you guys up before me, and we'll just keep running the same joke over and over, but you'll never get to finish it because I have another guy who is a comic dressed as Batman, and he kept interrupting them throughout the show until I came up, and then I like did the second half of the joke, you know?
You broke Batman's back.
And the crowd, I like grabbed him and got rid of him, you know? But that was hilarious. I fed my buddy Carl. He was Two-Face. He went first. I fed him a joke that's like 100% always worked, no problem, so he could at least get off to a good start. He goes up, of course, rips the microphone out of the cord. So now he's got to fix that.
Silent.
Well, it's like a packed house just laughing at him. And then he butchered the joke so bad. He said it like almost backwards, and it just made no sense.
What was the joke?
It was the one where I would say, I'm getting ready to be an uncle, right? That gets people clapping. They get excited. And I say, there's no due date or anything. It's just that my sister has been so reckless so far this year. So I'm getting ready. I just got to stay ready.
That's a good one.
And then I got a few lines after that. But I'm like, if you just get that right, they'll at least be hyped for what's going on, you know? And he almost told it backwards. I think he freaked out after he pulled the mic out, which all of us have done.
Of course.
But he just wasn't prepared to have to reset and then still remember, you know, because he's got a packed room all staring at him laughing. But it was fun. We figured it out.
Not for him.
No. I decided also to chug a beer. That was pretty badass. I put that on my Instagram. Yeah.
They threw that beer at you hard as fuck,
dude. That was Carl.
And you
caught it. Threw the beer at me. Yeah.
Meanwhile, I'm just in the crowd like, damn, dude, I'm such a nerd. Nick's so cool.
I'm so sad.
I'm so sad right
now.
So
sad.
That will go down as Bomb Margera. That's what we called it.
It is funny thinking of yourself as a nerd, though, when I'm basically nerding out with all of my friends being Batman villains, you know?
Yeah, but you guys were all cool jocks, though.
We were still cool Jack's jocks doing it, you know?
Is the homeless loser.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right. I'm in the Bane mask looking at Foskey. You know what a fucking loser you are? I just don't have anything in common with you. You're so weak and frail.
That is true. I am quite frail.
Speaking of Batman, you got Batman killing the worst Joker here.
True.
Oh, dude, I didn't even think about that. That's so true, man. Leto. Yeah, people hated his Joker.
He's the real American Psycho.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He had like a cult at one point.
I'm pretty sure isn't he still in a cult?
I think he
or
runs
is that
it.
Over now.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's his cult now.
Yeah.
I saw the headline and I was like, I don't want to know.
He like looks like Jesus now. He's got long hair, so it's understandable why people.
The singer of 30 Seconds to Mars, like, when will it be enough? When will it be enough for you, Jared
exactly.
Leto?
What more does he have to accomplish? There's the poncho.
Is that a rain jacket? Yes, it is.
Yes, it is. A little moonwalk before the murder.
So the next gift I got for both of you,
Get the fuck.
He got us the fucking
album.
Y'all
can choose which one.
Are you kidding me, dude? This is crazy.
I'm keeping four. Four is mine.
You take whichever one
you want.
You can take
When Sports came out in 83.
Huey Lewis. He really came into sound commercially.
You like Huey Lewis in the news?
They're okay.
Their early work was a little too new wave for my taste. But when Sports came out in 83, I think they really came into their own, commercially and artistically.
This is so sick, man.
Yeah, this one has I Want a New Drug. That's the big one for that. That's when they came into their own, commercially and artistically.
Here comes the big swing.
Right Weird
here.
Al's version, I Want a New Duck.
Yep. Dude, they sued the people who did the Ghostbusters theme because they just ripped off I Want a New Drug. If you think about it, it's the exact same beat and melody.
It is.
Yeah.
Oh.
Ghostbusters.
What a cool scene.
New drugs.
He just smokes a cigar.
He takes out the rain jacket, but his face is literally covered in blood. He had nothing to cover that.
He just didn't want to ruin the suit.
Just didn't want to hurt the suit. Yeah.
It's a good suit.
I respect it.
Right.
Got you one of your favorites.
Bill, a Ben Shapiro
is it Ben
shirt?
Shapiro?
Dude.
That's what I thought. Yeah.
Hold on. What do you think of that, Peach? On stage. Oh, I'm definitely gonna on one of the shows on this tour. I'm
it's the wrong size. And he just goes, "Facts don't care about your figure." Put it on.
Oh, dude, this is so sick.
So we should tell our audience we have a guy in the corner over here.
Oh yeah,
my PJ. High school friend PJ.
That's right.
Yeah,
along for the ride.
He hasn't been laughing much at our conversation, which has me a little worried.
I think he's mesmerized, but he's getting he's taking notes from Patrick.
He's in awe.
Yeah, he's never seen American Psycho.
Oh, man, this rules.
Now
dude.
He's at Paul Allen's place. Yeah.
Yeah.
When I get to Paul Allen's place, I can't help but thinking it's more expensive than mine.
It's overlooking the moment of sheer panic.
That's all of my neighbors.
Yeah,
me,
oh, that's right.
Me being like, I can't help but think the place is a lot nicer than my trailer.
Why do you think that you have beef with the neighbors?
Oh, I know I do.
But why?
Because they think for the longest time it's just been me and like a bunch of buddies living in this house.
Oh, okay.
And they all moved out. Like it was like me and two other guys for the longest time in this house. So for years we just were having there was beer cans out in the yard.
Oh yeah,
it was definitely.
They see you moving. They see you moving cameras in and out, and they're like, "Are you filming porn in there?" And you're like, yeah, "It's worse. We're doing a podcast."
I wish it was porn.
Right, we'd get more views,
more money too.
It would definitely get more views.
Oh, yeah, man. That's everybody.
You could do that, though. You could do it with popular pornos. You know, you get people on and you do the movies that way. All right. My name's been Bam Margera.
All right, Nick. I need to apologize for this gift in front, but I got you a shirt with a character I think you might be able to identify.
Oh, the Punisher? Is that what this is?
No.
Oh,
character you kind of have some similarities
Toy
to.
Toy Story. Yes, Sid. That's right. So
dude.
We used to do this show called You Look Like. They did it at the Laughing Skull in Atlanta. That was probably like 40 to 50% of the jokes that people said about me. It was You Look Like Sid from Toy Story. And it would always hit. But I wouldn't. You know, I would laugh in a decreasing manner because I'd already heard it.
Very Patrick Bateman-like laugh.
Yeah, exactly. Just plotting their murder. No, that's fair, though. Yeah. In fact, I think I posted that on my Instagram a few years back on the decade.
Mm-hmm.
Decade. But it wasn't me. It was young Sid. And then in the new Toy Story, when he's delivering, or he's like the trash guy in one of the notes, but he still has the same skull shirt.
Yeah,
so you
yeah.
know it's him as like a 18-year-old or something.
Which is ridiculous that, you know, is he buying a new shirt? Is that the same shirt he used to wear as a
yeah,
kid?
Yeah, exactly. Like, come
he
on,
just
man.
Keeps getting it in bigger sizes.
Yeah. He has
I
one outfit
like.
His whole life.
I always thought you looked like the moon, Nick.
You've told me that.
Yeah.
The moon?
Yeah.
My roast was he looks like if the moon got divorced.
Like, oh, I'm like the comic
me though.
Moon
just,
face?
Yeah, just a moon, yeah. Like the emoji.
Set this up right.
Yeah, hold
put,
on.
Yeah, show Huey some respect.
Just have it like that.
They definitely did some coke.
I'm going to have to do a lot of explaining when I wear this Ben Shapiro shirt around. What it would be even scarier is if people are cheering for it, then I'm just going to be like, nah, man.
Where'd you get that, man?
He is kind of awesome, though. Like, him just ranting about shit, I could seriously watch it all fucking day. But I just hate that there's people that take it seriously. His whole career is just built on being like, and technically, you think that I'm mad, but actually, you're the one that's mad. And then the college is like, yeah, here's $1,000. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, I saw he didn't like Barbie too much.
Oh, yeah.
I hadn't seen it.
That's got to be a fun one.
Yeah, yeah, I didn't watch it, but I was like, ooh.
I know. I wish I had seen it because I was with some friends, and I accidentally started an argument. Funny enough, they had a Philly accent, too, like Bam. But I was like, what'd you guys think of the Barbie movie? And his wife was like, oh, I thought it was great. And he's like, no, they're trying to take away masculinity. they're taking away our masculinity with this movie.
Then you see his Oppenheimer review. He's like, we should have dropped 3 bombs.
Yeah. But it's like, it's the Barbie movie. Were you watching that thinking that was for the boys? That movie's not for the boys.
What was the movie? Maybe it was Wonder Woman or something where they were doing like private women's only viewings in like Texas or something. And a bunch of dudes were complaining. And it's like, do you want to go to that? I think Bill Burr talked about it on his podcast. Like, do you want to sit through that? You want to sit at the lady movie with all the ladies? That's their thing. We have our thing. It's fine. There's no need to get upset about fucking Barbie. Let them have their little whatever, and then we'll go watch Oppenheimer for a palate cleanser, you know?
Have y'all seen Oppenheimer?
I actually have not seen the movie, no.
I haven't seen it either.
All right.
Have you seen it?
Yeah, I fell asleep, though, after the bomb went off. I was, like, fighting it.
You could
like...
sleep soundly after that.
Nice. That's probably the most American review of that movie.
Oh, yeah. I slept soundly after that second bomb went off.
Sleep I've had in a while.
All right, don't have to worry about nuclear war now. I went on a few dates with this Asian girl, and we're not, no longer, I think, because I told her I fell asleep, and she was like, I watched the movie. How could anyone fall asleep during that?
You're like, yeah, we saw the action already. I was bored.
It's just a movie about they made the bomb, and that's it. That's
I don't
all
care.
I need
yeah,
to know.
I don't care that the hot Peaky Blinders guy is in it. I tapped out.
What's the last movie I've seen in the theaters? Any idea?
Fast X.
Fast X.
Yeah, I saw that with my buddy Mike.
I saw Babylon. That like movie that's like about Hollywood.
Oh yeah.
I think it really got swept under the Rory Scovel's in it though, which was kind of cool. So that was good. But it was the most boring up its own ass Hollywood movie that I've ever fucking seen. I was just like, what is this? Is it in the 20s? Is it was just not good. Tobey Maguire plays like this creepy old dude. He kind of looks like
he's a loser homeless guy.
Yeah. But yeah, I think Babylon was the last one I saw.
I never even
theaters.
Heard of that movie. What is that about?
I don't know. I don't know how to explain
it. It's not actual
it's,
Babylon.
It's just about Hollywood in the 20s, basically.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
One of my buddies works as an editor, and he got hired to do that movie.
Well, he didn't do a very good job because that movie is 3.5 hours.
Call him out, dude.
He's not the main editor.
Call his
but
name, dude.
He
Say
said the
name.
Director, they brought him on and were like, hey, we're just going to do this for like 6 weeks, like in and out type of thing. And they worked on it for like 6 months because the director just didn't like what he had.
You could tell that actually that makes sense because you could tell these scenes were just put together to be like, all right, maybe put this one here. I don't know. Let's cut to Rory some more. He's funny.
Damn.
I know. Shout out to Rory, though.
He's like the drug dealer, right? Yeah, yeah.
It's always cool to see comedians and things. I will always support that, sure. No matter how crappy the movie is.
There's old Jim Carrey getting it again.
Hell yeah, dude.
1,000 crunches. How many crunches do you think y'all could do right now?
3.
I could do like 17. Not that many, dude.
That's a very realistic.
I'm not an athlete anymore, man. There was a time and a place. Now the knees are going. The back's shot. I don't need to do 1,000 push-ups anymore, you know?
Do y'all get random back pain?
Oh, yeah, dude.
Yeah, you guys are pretty tall also. You got to have some back shit going on.
I had it happen to me the other day. I could barely get out of bed, and I just called Nick, and it was like the Louis joke. He's like, yeah, that starts to happen.
Yeah.
That's so true, man. That's why that bit's so good.
It's like, well, what do I do? And it's like, well, just enjoy the time when it doesn't hurt.
even the doctor on Louis, where he's like explaining why. He's like, humans are not meant to stand up. We're meant to be or whatever. He's talking about how...
You're essentially using a clothesline as a flagpole. I remember that line.
Yeah. Just the idea that we're upright is going to fuck with your back, whereas if you were still on all fours, then, you know, obviously you wouldn't have
as much
low back pain. But it's just funny
your back
how
would feel great, but you have zero friends walking around like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. but it's just hilarious how matter-of-factly the doctor says it. Like, well, he's just eating a sandwich.
We were given a clothesline, and we're using it as a flagpole. So what should I do? use your back as it was intended. Walk around on your hands and feet. Or accept the fact that your back is going to hurt sometime. Be very grateful for the moments that it doesn't.
Is that Ricky Gervais or is that because no, he's a doctor
that's a
on
different
there too?
Episode. This is the super old guy who coaches him about life. Oh, a little bit sometimes.
One of the best lines of the series, I think, in there.
He's great.
I forget what he says. I can't quote it, but he has some line about breakups or whatever that he's like, oh wow, that's really true. I can't remember what it is though. Sorry.
I think about how like the breakup is the missing her, longing her. This is love.
Exactly. You're lucky to feel that pain. You're lucky to miss her because that means you loved her or whatever. Yeah. It's like, that's true. Let's all cry now.
You are a classic idiot. You think spending time with her, kissing her, having fun with her, you think that's what it was all about? That was love?
Yeah.
This is love, missing her because she's gone, wanting to die. You're so lucky. You're like a walking poem. Would you rather be some kind of a fantasy, some kind of a Disney ride? Is that what you want? Don't you see, this is the good part. This is what you've been digging for all this time. Now you finally have it in your hand, this sweet nugget of love. Sweet, sad love. And you want to throw it away. You've got it all wrong.
What? I thought this was the bad part.
No. The bad part is when you forget her. When you don't care about her, when you don't care about anything. The bad part is coming, so enjoy the heartbreak while you can, for God's sakes.
You know, that's some people's interpretation of love. Some other people's interpretation of love is murdering prostitutes in your own apartment. It just depends, you know.
Love looks different for different people.
Love looks different, man.
Nick, I know you play basketball. Do you have any, like, favorite basketball movie or anything? Or sports movie?
Jeez. The first one that pops in my head is Coach Carter, just because I've seen it so many times. There's some funny parts of that movie.
Time,
Samuel L. Jackson coming in, turning the team around.
Channing Tatum.
Beating up the players, basically. No, he just wants them to get a C average, and every parent in the neighborhood's like, come on! This fucking new coach, man! Just get a C, man. Come on, dude. Can't expect my son to read and dunk.
Gotta pick one.
Semi-pro's a fun one.
Oh, yeah, that's
a lot
great.
Of my teammates liked that one. Will Ferrell's really funny in that one.
Andre 3000,
yeah, dude, he's good.
Coffee Black.
Fucking Woody Harrelson is in the movie also. He's very funny.
He's in a new thing about basketball where he teaches players with special needs.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, watch that.
D's in it from Always Sunny.
Caitlin Wilson.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Nice.
I need to check that out. I need to watch that.
Yeah.
Have you watched Showtime any?
Oh, dude, don't even get me started, bro. Winning Time is my favorite thing that I've ever
done. I read the book, actually. The book is great.
I did, too. That's Showtime. Like, that's why I called it that, I think.
Oh, it's great.
Adrian Brody is Pat Riley, man. One of the best casting choices that I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I love Jason Segel as Paul Westhead, too, because he just becomes such a dick.
He becomes so unlikable.
Yeah.
It's the first time I've ever seen him like be that unlikable, too. Like, usually he plays just like his goofy self.
Yeah, Jason Segel fucking rules, man.
He's awesome.
I loved him on Freaks and Geeks. I really related to that character.
Mm-hmm.
Except instead of drums, it was guitar. Yeah. But that was totally me in high school. Just falling for girls who are uninterested and being obsessed with music.
The scene where he tries out for the band or the drumming.
Oh my God. And he looks all happy.
I
want to
throw up when I watch it. Just because it's like, oh man, I've been there before where you just think you're a lot better than you are and you play with other musicians and you're like, oh crap.
Yeah.
I need to go back to my basement.
That's such a classic scene, dude. We have a friend that looks like him. That's that picture of him playing the drums is still my contact picture for him to this day. But yeah, dude, Showtime is the best. I can't wait for the series or the season finale.
Is there only one more?
Yeah, they're only doing 7 episodes this season. They might cancel it because not enough people are watching it.
What?
Mm-hmm.
I know. I know.
That's insane. It's like appointment television. I'm watching it on Sunday nights, like when it drops.
Dude, me too. It's they can't take this away. We have to get to the AIDS. They're not getting to the AIDS.
Oh yeah, we got to get to the AIDS.
It was kind of corny in the first season, though, because, like, you know, something would happen, and then the guy would turn to the camera and be like, looks like they need a little bit of magic. And I'm like, ah, okay. But they kind of stopped doing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought the last episode was like one of the best. And the Larry Bird focused episode.
We were
was
talking
great.
About Larry Bird yeah. today.
Larry Bird fucking rules, man. That guy playing basketball in jeans.
Yeah, and boots.
When he rips the cig at the halftime of the exhibition games, like, I'm going in.
Yeah, dude.
He didn't give a shit, dude. Larry Bird's the best.
Number one trash talker of all time, apparently.
Oh, dude, there's thousands of TikToks of guys talking about the shit he would say. Man.
You ain't even fit to play in this league, Holmes, to Dominique Wilkins.
Holmes. Yeah.
Did he just call me Holmes?
Yeah, yeah. I know he did. Went to the 3-point contest and it was just like, which one are you going for second place?
Did he take off his warm up?
Yeah, he won his warm up. I mean, he would tell people where he was going to shoot from and then just do it anyway and make it anyway. And
you got the white guy guarding me?
Yep, yep. He was one of the first to start doing that shit. Mm-hmm. Like, you disrespecting me by guarding me with a white guy.
I even love just how he just mows his grass every Saturday. Like, people would come and watch.
Yeah, that was what made the him versus Magic so compelling, because Magic's the face of the camera. He's got the smile, right? And Larry just wants to, you know, be mowing the lawn in Indiana somewhere.
Drinking
you
butt
know?
Heavy.
But they're both just amazing basketball players, you know? So it was a nice contrast, I think.
We need something like that again, man. That would be great. Just another, like, is there
good white guy?
No, just like a rivalry that's like just so defined. Like, do they have that in basketball now, really?
Now, I think the last major team rivalry was probably the Cavaliers and the Warriors when they played like 3 out of 4 years or something.
Yeah, true.
The Spurs were there for a while. I mean, now it's, you know, the Nuggets might be around for a while because nobody can stop Jokic and Jamal Murray. LeBron's like almost 40. I mean, he's still good, but the Lakers kind of struggle. I don't know. I don't know if there's two. I mean, I was just thinking of the women's game, and some people have made this point of, yeah, while we're trying to talk about empowering women while Patrick Bateman is about to murder two prostitutes.
Dude, so the funniest thing I learned about this movie, and I read it, and I was like, that can't be true. And I read it again, and I just kept laughing. They said that when they were trying to figure out all the positions for this threesome, that him and the director like watched a bunch of porn together, and he drew stick figures of the way that they should have sex.
You're right. This is better than women's basketball to talk about. This is good.
Dude, and I love how like bored they are. Like they're just actively bored while this is going on and
exactly.
Making fun of him for his music taste.
Right, right. But yeah, before he starts going crazy, Caitlin Clark from Iowa, shout out to Iowa basketball, and then Angel Reese from LSU. That was the championship this past year. I mean, there was a little Magic Bird stuff going on there, kind of like with that kind of rivalry. And they're definitely both going to go to the WNBA.
I could see Trae Young and Luka, because they usually, you know, Atlanta.
Well, that
they
would make sense too, because they were the ones that were actually traded
against
for
each other.
Their teams can't get their shit together.
So Nick, you kind of mentioned this movie bombing when you showed it to your girlfriend. Have y'all ever had a movie that y'all like try to get a friend group to watch and it just bombs and everyone hates it?
Yes.
Well, I know what was the movie.
It was The Ref. It's a 90s comedy with Dennis Leary in it.
Mm-hmm.
And every line in it is a jab. It's one of my favorite movies ever. But basically, Kevin Spacey and his wife, I think it's Julia Davis plays his wife. They have a bad marriage, and on the way home from marriage counseling, she goes into the store and gets like held hostage by Dennis Leary. So he gets back in the car, and it's on Christmas Eve, so now he's holding them hostage at their own house. But their bickering starts to kind of hold him hostage. And then the family shows up, and they have to figure out a way to like not get caught, and they're doing house-to-house searches. I think it's one of the funniest movies ever, but it just they weren't into it. Kevin Spacey has this one line. Because they have this like really mean grandma, and he just goes, "Mother, is it possible for you to shut the fuck up for 10 seconds?
It's a funny one.
And then like immediately after, she's like, "You can't talk to me like that." He's like, "You know what I'm going to get you for Christmas next year, Mom? A big wooden cross. That way, if you ever feel unappreciated for your sacrifices, you can climb on up and nail yourself to it." And every line in the movie is like that.
And your buddy's just staring at the TV. Like,
nothing,
dude. It's not doing anything for me, man.
Nothing. It was J.K. Simmons' first on-screen appearance. They have a kid who's, like, blackmailing him. It's you watch The Ref.
No, I'll check it out.
It's hilarious. It might be my favorite comedy besides Walk Hard.
Lockhart's a great one too.
That's a perfect movie.
It was a particularly bad case of someone being sawed in half.
Yeah. I love Jack White as Elvis in that movie.
Oh, yeah.
A little bit of a little dang old lookout, man. Yeah. It just scares him.
There's two things you need to know. All right. I'm a king. And number two is look out, man. Look at that. They're coming at you. You see that? It's called karate, man. And only two kinds of people know it. The Chinese and the king. One of them is me.
I remember this movie my buddy picked. It was back in the Blockbuster days. We used to go to Blockbuster and just pick some random shit. And we
used to
return
some videotapes.
There you go. Yeah. We used to,
he just said it. Sorry.
Whoa. Yeah.
I guess I was probably returning videotapes.
We used to pick some like random shitty sci-fi movies, like even named, almost like bad pornos, like Sasquatch Mountain. And we're talking like the CGI is so bad. They show the actor, then they cut to CGI of a very obviously fake Sasquatch. And then they cut back to the actor, and now he's just missing an arm. Like, there's no action that happens, you know? That's how low budget.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever reason, my buddy wanted to see one about aliens, and he picked this one called, like, Red Planet or something, some weird one. And we spent, like, the first hour waiting to see the aliens. They get to Mars, and then they just walk around for, like, an hour. We were so bored, and we were giving him shit. Like, Wednesday, he's like, come on, it's coming, come on. I think one guy, like, dies because his helmet pops or something, but we're like, where are the aliens? And finally, the movie was on for so long, we decided to fast forward. Like, let's just find it. We fast forward for like 5 minutes, the credits come on. The movie's just over. They just walk around Mars, one guy unscrews his helmet accidentally, and then the movie's over. Like, there's no action, there's no, we made fun of him for years for picking that movie. Just nothing happens. They go to Mars and nothing happens. Imagine that Matt Damon movie. What's that one called? Martian.
Yeah, Martian.
If he just goes and he just walks around Mars for like 2 hours and then it's just over. People would be furious.
Like, damn, I can't get off here and just die.
I think I saw you did a jersey swap the other day.
Dude, this is crazy how many gifts you guys have. This is
wanted
awesome.
To remind you have a good woman at home.
Oh, look at this.
You don't need bada bings.
You know what? I see these at the store. What are these? What is this? Pop television? What
it's
is
this? It's just a little Funko Pop. It's like just a small cartoon version of the person.
Well, surely this won't creep anyone out that I bring over to my apartment, right?
Not at all.
This little big-headed lady sitting on the thing.
Carmella Soprano.
Yeah, is that a character? Oh, wait. Oh, that's from the actual Sopranos.
You didn't watch the Sopranos, bro.
No. Give me a second to take in the information. Look at this thing.
Also, wait.
You look at this, go, oh, from the Sopranos. Yeah.
Also, if you guys knew how little of room we have in our car right now, it is like a caravan in there with all of our shit. Nick has all his merch. We got our bags because we're going to be on the road for 10 days.
We're locked and loaded, man. Yeah.
But, dude, these gifts, man.
I hope you brought your record player.
I'm going to put this up in between my T-shirts. I'm like, this goes for $500. Anybody wants to buy this? This is actual to scale Carmella Soprano.
Tony.
Yeah.
So you're not even a fan of The Sopranos?
You know what? I have only watched bits and pieces. I'm not like a diehard. I haven't seen the whole thing.
I saw the jersey swap and I was like, bada bings.
Dude, that was the other guy's shirt. So that wasn't my thing.
Damn. That's what a jersey swap is.
No, but that's still good. That's still good.
Is this the first time one of your Nardwar deep dive gifts has
Nardwar,
has got...
that's the guy whose name I was trying to remember. Yeah, that's what you guys fucking did on us, man. This is impressive. Yeah.
Didn't pan out. Yeah.
No, you're batting 1,000 with me, but...
No, I mean, listen, dude. I'm still on board.
Nick didn't watch The Sopranos,
Game of Thrones, Succession. You know, I've seen bits and pieces of different episodes, but I have not seen any of those in their entirety. Yeah, just a fan.
That's probably for the best. You're like writing jokes, and meanwhile, I'm just turning my brain off watching this shit.
It's not turning your brain off. It's outstanding writing, all of those shows. So it's like you still get something out of whatever you're watching. Yeah, I was at a watch party just by chance of the series finale of Game of Thrones, the one that upset everybody.
Oh, yeah.
And that was hilarious to me.
I agree. I never got into it.
Because I was not invested, so I wasn't upset at all.
I was so tired of everyone being like, it's the greatest show on TV.
They were acting like the Super Bowl ended in a tie or something. That's how mad they were. Mm-hmm. Like, something happens, must have to happen more. We need something here.
I could never, like, when it comes to, like, fantasy movies, I could only do Star Wars. I could never do, like, the medieval movies or anything like that for
some reason. I got a little bit into Lord of the Rings, but, yeah, I'm definitely Star Wars all the way, for sure. I don't even know that much about Star Trek. I know the character names and shit, but Star Wars, for sure.
Way better.
Oh, yeah.
What's your favorite Star Wars?
Oh, dude. Revenge of the Sith, man. Come on. When he turns into Darth Vader.
I think mine's Return of the Jedi. Just all the Jabba's Palace stuff is just so great. That's, yeah.
The Ewoks, that's what got you.
Yeah, probably as a kid.
I mean, those are the better movies, structurally speaking, right? Like, because they were the originals and all that stuff. And then everybody shits on the prequels. Nobody ranks the new ones, right? I don't think anybody...
No. I think everyone hates the new ones.
As soon as a woman picked up the lightsaber, like, okay, come on with the fantasy here.
I've probably watched The Phantom Menace the most times, though.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because I had a video of it when I was a kid. And so, like, you know, it was before, like, Netflix and shit. So I would just watch The Phantom Menace a million times.
Pod race. I mean, Phantom
the pod
Menace
race
great.
Is maybe one of the best parts
pod
of Star
racing
Wars.
And then Darth Maul.
Yeah.
From Phantom
dude,
Menace.
Darth Maul should not have gone out that early.
He's, like, the coolest character in the whole thing to me, dude.
Qui-Gon, too.
Qui-Gon's sick. Qui-Gon's awesome. Yeah.
Rat tails. Jedi rat tails.
Well, that's the coolest part about Darth Maul. He gets to kill somebody and then also get killed. I appreciated that. It's a lot happening in like a 10-minute window, you know? It's sick. And the double lightsaber. Dude, back then, that was
I remember.
Like,
it was huge.
People lost their shit. My buddy, one of my best friends when I was, I don't know, what was that, third grade I was in maybe when those were coming out? His parents, we would do a sleepover. His parents would wake us up at like 2 a.m. or something. Take us to the theater for the premiere release. It was sick as fuck. So we got to see like the first showing of it at, you know, whatever, 1 a.m., 2 a.m. And when that fucking double lightsaber went off, dude, that theater went insane. Like, oh my God.
And the soundtrack,
awesome.
Too. The
it's
fucking
great. It's
Duel,
great.
Duel of the Fates.
Yeah, the
is
doors
the best
open
Star Wars
and
song.
It just fucking comes in. It's great, dude.
Oh,
yeah,
doors closing.
Oh, it's so good, man. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that. Vastly makes up for the sand lines that what's his name?
I hate
Hayden
sand everywhere.
Yeah, everybody shits on that, dude. Whatever, man. You know, there's some good and some bad, right? Darth Maul way cooler.
Well, that's
that
the second. That's Attack of the Clones.
A stupid line. Yeah. Well, whatever. You know, for all the prequels. You know, I know they gave him shit for that, but I thought it was good acting in Revenge of the Sith when he's like losing his mind and turning into Darth Vader and crying
it's
and freaking
best
out
of the. I don't know.
Well,
Order
what
happened?
There's some revisionist history on all of that because what happened was we were all kids when we saw it. So,
well, there's that too.
So we weren't the people writing the blogs about it. Right. That was all the comic book balding, receding hair, ponytail people.
Yeah, yeah.
Worst cosmic wars ever. I will only see it three more times today.
But then, now that we're all adults, like I think the prequels have kind of gotten their shine.
I guess I should say Jar Jar Binks. I know everybody hated him. Darth Maul makes up for Jar Jar Binks, in my opinion.
But it sucks seeing it as a kid because there was a time where I was like, yeah, Jar Jar's pretty cool. You know, I didn't have a problem with him when I was 8 years old.
That's who the target audience was for that
and
character.
Weirdly, that character feels very like racist in a Star Wars way.
Oh, totally. But the worst ones were the Nemoidians.
Oh, yeah, the Confederate, the trade.
They must have stopped the blockade.
They were like, dude.
Jesus. The war is over.
It's like, all right, you don't have to fucking come on, man.
Yeah, George Lucas must have something with Asians, man, because there's that. And
I heard
there's...
that those guys are in Oppenheimer also, by the way.
Well, just for a little bit.
That'd be so fucking funny.
Cool it with the anti-Semitic remarks.
Yes, dude.
I love that line in this movie. Just,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, I'll kill people, but let's cool it with the Jew stuff.
You don't spin a menorah, you spin a dreidel.
But yeah, dude, I like definitely that third one, man. Ewan McGregor, outstanding.
Yeah, he's great.
I mean, he's got his own fucking TV show now.
I even
like
the
Obi-Wan.
I have not watched all of Obi-Wan.
There's hit and miss moments, but there is a fight between him and like Hayden Christensen like as Darth Vader.
So I saw a million TikToks of that. Love that.
Yeah,
love that whole sequence. It's great.
There's some good moments in it.
I got really into The Mandalorian when that came out.
Yeah.
Because that was kind of during the pandemic a little bit too, right? So everybody was in their house already. Yeah. That was a cool...
The Boba Fett show was pretty cool too.
He always says I look like the all the clones.
You kind of do.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, I see it.
All right, well, the last thing I got you.
Okay, let's see. What is this? Bruh, you're going to make me cry on this, dude.
They keep topping themselves.
Look at that.
Oh!
Look at that.
That's nasty.
This is
nasty right there.
5 stars, dude. 10 out of 10. That's perfect, sick, fucking game.
It makes up for the Carmelo Funko Pop. That's sick,
dude. Yeah, man. Throw this back.
Look at that. Look at that, Peach. I got a plaque.
I know I don't have an album out, bro. Okay? You don't have to rub it in.
You got
to
put that album out, Nick. The people want to see it.
I know, right?
Get Mike to record it for you for the low.
Yeah, I know, dude. We'll do something.
Since you were here last, didn't you put an album out and you moved to New York, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, Foskey's killing it, man.
Things are looking up, man. New York was a little tough at first, but now it's getting a lot better.
And settling in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just crazy when you move up there and then you're just like, okay, everybody here is really good and this is really scary.
Did it feel weird, I guess, like kind of like starting over?
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of that. Like, I was thinking about that, where it really hits you when you're at the Pine Box open mic at 5:30 p.m., and you're like, I'm going up 45th, and I have a special out right now. Comedy has a way of keeping you humble.
We both did that like 4 or 5 years ago. Put us second to last and last. We both just ate it. I'm like,
yep.
All right, this is New York.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. One day, though, I'll get a Paul Allen apartment there, and it'll be great.
No Rolex.
No. It's going to overlook the park. It's going to be sick.
We hadn't talked about William Dafoe, but he's great too in this movie.
He's such a good actor.
Well, you know the
man.
Story about that, right?
I did not.
So the director had him do each scene 3 times. One time where he's completely oblivious, one time where he's like suspicious but not really sure, and then one where he like knows for sure that he did the murder. And then she just randomly, not even strategically, like randomly picked different ones from it, so you just can never tell where he's coming from. That's like why he seems so like mysterious and ominous. And that also is part of my theory of why it's all in Patrick's head.
I personally think it's all in his head, too.
Yep.
And that last line when they're having that last conversation with the lawyer, when he's just like, what are you talking about? Like, this is hilarious.
Also
like,
a very funny scene.
Yeah.
Why isn't it possible, you stupid bastard? Because I had dinner with Paul Allen 3 weeks ago. Or so he says something like that.
Yeah, like last week or something.
Yeah, yeah,
he's just
yeah,
like,
yeah.
What?
Why isn't it possible?
It's just not.
Why not, you stupid bastard?
Because I had dinner with Paul Allen twice in London just 10 days ago.
Put it in the can.
Oh, yeah. Don't set the
spoon. She almost puts the spoon on the table.
Yeah. And that's when he's like, I'm murdering.
Yeah, I'm killing this shit.
For sure.
Just she doesn't respect
nothing.
Wood.
Yeah, yeah.
Dude, and that would have sucked, by the way.
Nail gun to the back of the head.
A nail gun.
Yeah, because I don't think that would kill you right away.
I don't think it would either.
I think you'd just be like,
you
duh,
would just,
and just
yeah,
be in a lot of
be
pain.
Confused. You'd be drawing stick figures of people having sex.
Yeah.
You'd be non-binary for like 5 seconds.
You're canceled, Nick. Give us your gift.
I thought, like, should I say this or not? Nah, whatever, dude.
No one's going to watch this.
I'm not going to get SNL, so it doesn't matter.
He's had enough.
PJ's a fucking trooper, man. He's been hanging in for all of our little comedy.
He's been looking
stuff.
At his
he's been
phone
sitting
frowning
in the couch
for an hour now.
Him and his tequila have been hanging in there.
He got so drunk off tequila this morning to get out of driving responsibilities. And it's funny because it's like, well, we don't want a drunk person to drive, so I guess you win.
He kind of outsmarted us.
He
know?
Did, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
That's genius. One of the off-topic questions we've been asking our guests.
Yeah.
I don't think we asked you this last time, but how did you find out Santa Claus wasn't real?
Good question. I think I asked my dad, and my dad was just like, yeah, no, he's not real.
Dude, our parents were actually pretty thorough. My dad, they used to do a cookie out, but they would take a bite out.
Mm-hmm.
So for like a 3-year-old, you're like, well, the cookie's missing a bite. Clearly.
He was here.
But then he would do, he would put like flour by the fireplace, put 2 boot prints in it. He did like a few things like that. And you're like, well, clearly, you know, for a 3-year-old, that's enough evidence that this magical man is real.
I was buying it at like 12
yeah.
still.
Yeah, man. I mean, I don't remember the exact day. Or maybe I was just at that age where by the time they told me, I was like, oh yeah, I don't really care. It's fine, you know? But I don't really remember being sat down. But my dad was thorough about that shit. So
even if I knew and I saw boot prints, I'd be like,
yeah, for sure,
whoa,
man.
Whoa.
Even if you were like 25 and you saw boot prints by the
whoa.
Fireplace, you're like, I got to get a Ring camera or something.
I got down
what
there.
What is going on?
Yeah. Well, I remember finding out. So first was the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny that I found out weren't real, and then I found out about Santa Claus. And then in my head, I was like, okay, God is next. That's what I'm going to find out about.
Any day now, they're going to tell me.
Yeah, and I like asked my parents, I'm like, so God's not real, right? And they're like, yes, he is. I'm just like, okay, all right.
You see boot prints in church? Like, oh, wow. There's a bite out of the communion cracker. Oh, my goodness.
You know God.
God must be real.
Going, Jesus just going from church to church eating himself. I was so convinced. I was like, all right, they're going to tell me God any day now.
Right.
And then they're like, nope, you're going to Catholic school.
Yeah.
It made me so mad when I found out the Tooth Fairy wasn't real, and then I just kept believing in everything else, just being like, yeah, that was stupid that I thought the Tooth Fairy was real.
Well, it's dominoes at that point, right? Where you're just like, God damn it, that too? Oh, man, it just flips everything upside down, you know?
Yeah.
There was an Easter where there was a fucking rabbit in our backyard.
No way.
So for our parents, that's easy money right there.
Are you sure your dad didn't play that?
Yeah, your dad seemed pretty good.
He just went out and caught one and released it.
Yeah. I mean, that's also true. Yeah. We might have ate it later that night. I would have never known, you know?
Our grandma one time, we were like in the car with our parents, and my mom was like, there was a plane going overhead. And my mom was like, oh, wow, look at that. I think that's Santa's sleigh. And she looked out the window and goes, Kim, no, it's not. That's a plane.
It's an airplane.
Me and Reed were just like, oh.
Yeah, see, it's not that easy, you know? If there was like a raccoon in our backyard, my mom's like, there goes the Easter Bunny. It's like, no, come on.
William Dafoe always, even when you're talking about the three takes, that makes sense. But he always has a way like where I'm like, he knows something I don't know.
Oh, yeah, he was great in Mississippi Burning as the detective.
Well, and in
Boondock Saints.
Yeah, Boondock Saints.
God, I love that movie, man.
He's dressing like a lady and listening to music.
Yeah, he just listens to music
around.
And just perfectly.
Those are the best scenes
in
the
happens.
Movie. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Those are awesome when he's listening to his music and just kind of.
Yeah, and he just nails it every time.
And he's great in Spider-Man.
Those are my Spider-Mans, by the way. Those Tobey Maguire ones, you know?
The originals.
Now you got all this. What's the British kid's
Tom
name?
Holland.
Tom Holland. Yeah, I don't need all that.
We've had a whole episode about how he's not our Spider-Man.
Right.
I like Andrew Garfield.
Those are the ones I know the least about, just because Tom Holland's the one in all the Marvel shit, right?
It's arguably the worst Spider-Man movies, but he's a great Spider-Man. But the Tobey movies are the best.
Dude, those are the originals, man. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Those are our episode 4, 5, and 6.
Yeah, for sure.
Except for the third one.
The third one with what? Sandman
when he's like
and,
Spider-Man's dance.
I like it now.
All black dancing down the street.
Yeah, that's their sand. That's the sand part for those people. Yeah.
He like goes in the jazz club. And
I also
gets on the table.
Mm-hmm. I also like the Venom. The Tom. Why am I blanking on his last
name? Tom Hardy.
Tom Hardy. Yeah. I like his Venom more than. The Venom from the third movie with the guy from That 70s Show.
Yeah,
Danny Masterson, of course.
Yeah, no. He's like the same size as Spider-Man.
Topher Grace, yeah.
He keeps the real monster.
Yeah, he just doesn't sound as threatening.
No, he's a bad cast.
In the new Venom movies, he's got the voice. You know, he's got that raspy, creepy voice. And he looks like the Venom. I like those movies. People shitted on the Venom.
I like Venom
movies, but I liked them.
As someone that grew up liking Spider-Man, I liked Venom.
Dude, Woody Harrelson as Carnage, that was a fun movie.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be fun. It's like Fast X that I saw 2 months ago. Is it artistic cinema? No. But it's fun. It's a fun movie, you know?
Have y'all ever walked out in a movie?
Ooh, good question. I think I didn't walk out, but when I was a little kid, my mom took me to see the movie Spirit, the movie about that horse. And I just, I thought it was like a girl movie, and I sat backwards in the chair at the movie theater out of protest.
Like leaning on the seat.
Well, I was so small, I could just crisscross, just sit on it and face the other way. And then when I got older, my mom told me that her older brother Vinny, when they went to see The Sound of Music, did the exact same thing.
It's Hereditary.
Sound of Music was a weird movie. I think because aren't they like Nazis or something? And then they're all singing in a field. It's weird.
The hills are alive.
I'm trying to ease you into the history. You know? Yeah.
And I'm like, are Nazis real? They're like, oh, yes. Yes, they are.
FIFA Jew.
I never walked out of a movie, but I remember one of the more confusing ones. It was one of the newer Planet of the Apes when they're showing the origin story of how it all started with James Franco. Did you ever see that one?
I like that one, yeah.
With Draco Malfoy, he's in it.
He's like the monkey abuser.
Yeah.
He works at the zoo. Monkey place.
I remember people getting like just confused about the movie, and then the first words of the chimp, Caesar, he says, "Oh
no.
Yeah." He goes, "No!" And this lady in the back, it's a packed theater, goes, what the fuck? Everybody laughed so hard, dude.
She had no idea what she was watching.
I guess. Yeah, man.
Wait, these apes are going to talk?
Yeah, I like to think she just didn't know any of the previous movies at all. This is just her first exposure to the universe, you know? And now they're talking all of a sudden. What the fuck are we doing, man? Whose idea was this?
What's the craziest shit y'all ever snuck into a theater?
Oh, good question. Oh, probably a dab pen. That's not that exciting of an answer.
Yeah, I don't think we were that cool. Probably just like $20 worth of candy, you know?
Yeah. I don't have a good answer either. You'd be surprised what some people
say.
You
go buy it from CVS and then, you know, stuff it in your jacket or whatever.
Maybe like little mini liquor bottles.
I still get
a rush.
Maybe
some of that, yeah. We might have drank a little bit, you know?
No one's ever confronted me sneaking a drink or food in, but anytime I go to a theater and I have it, I'm just like...
Yeah, you still...
Yeah, it's one of your little thrills. You got to have little thrills in life.
We had a buddy bring in wine, and like him and his girlfriend were drinking. He like set it on the ground. Yeah. It was like one of those concrete theater, and kicked it over, and you could just hear the bottle like rolling.
You're like, it's gonna break in one of these, dude.
Another thing I wrote down that I love is when he asked the prostitute, "Do you take credit card?" I'm joking. Get in.
Do you take a credit card? I'm joking. Come on, get in.
Yeah, and it's extra funny because nobody laughs at any of his jokes.
Yeah.
The homeless guy, the prostitute, you know, he appreciates the ridiculousness of all this shit, but the jokes are just flying over people's heads. I think it makes them funnier.
Makes them a little more three-dimensional for sure.
More relatable for me.
Yeah, exactly.
My favorite line is the "I've got to return some videotapes." Like, me and my buddy would just always quote that to each other.
Oh, yeah.
But what back in the Blockbuster days, was there ever a movie or a video game or something that you racked up the most late fees?
Gremlins 2. I really liked that movie. I was really, really obsessed with it. It seemed like a meta comment on like media in general. And I remember I got that as a kid. I could understand. They're at the Clamp Tower, which
you weren't sitting backwards during this one.
Hell no, dude. Gremlins rules. But they're at Clamp Tower, which is supposed to be Trump Tower. And they're talking about how like the media is getting out of control and look what happened. He became president.
Gremlins 2.
And the media is out of control.
Yeah.
Of all the movies, Gremlins 2. Who would have thought?
Yeah, Gremlins 2 and Ref.
That's right. I will defend the Ref forever.
I mean, you have to appreciate the accuracy. He drops the chainsaw from like four stories,
and like no one hears the chainsaw.
Well, yeah, that's
no
the other
one
thing.
Hears her beating and running.
That's why it also seems like kind of imagined, you know? Because surely somebody would come out of their room and just be like, "What?"
They're
the
probably
fuck
all
is
listening
on?
To Phil Collins.
Yeah. He's just jogging naked with a chainsaw.
They said that routinely.
Yeah, shoes
are
on,
great.
Man.
They said routinely, like when he was filming this, he would just be hanging out, like with just a sock on his dong in the shoes, just like talking to people in
the
cast.
Dude, you gotta get
in between
character,
tapes.
Man. Yeah.
His timing. I really admire his timing, though, here with the drop.
Dropping the chainsaw?
It's like he's done it before.
All she had to do was just stop running, and he would have missed.
And boom. That had to be so satisfying,
see,
though, as the character.
He drops it straight down, but then
that's
they have it
such
flipping.
A sinister laugh, too.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He dropped it straight, but then they had it rotating in the air.
He timed it.
I don't think he put any spin on it.
Yeah, it looked like he dropped it just
it
straight.
It looked like he just did a straight drop. Now he's just drawing
now, all
of
I can
it.
Picture now is him drawing the sex figures the same way, though.
Oh, yeah, while he's breaking up with his girlfriend, he's just drawing this shit.
This is what PJ's
could you imagine, like,
outside.
Being at this nice restaurant and him be like, "Hey, can I get some crayons for the table, please?"
All right, last question I got for y'all. What's the best gift I've ever received or given?
Mine was a Carmelo Soprano.
I fucking knew you were going
to
say
that. Oh, are you giving that to someone?
Honestly, dude, the All Things Sacred plaque might be my new favorite gift that I've ever received.
That's
best gift that I've ever given. I like to give gifts to people.
My comedy.
I gave my friend who's from D.C. an Alex Ovechkin rookie jersey.
That's sick.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw you went to Tampa Bay game. Like,
dude, I saw the
Stanley
Cup.
Cup.
Yeah.
I saw it happen. My dad lives in Florida, and he was like, "I looked at tickets for game 6. Like, we can do this. Let's go." And so what the best part about all of it was the Tampa fans all left. So when they were bringing out the cup, we were like right on the glass. We just could walk right down. Nobody stayed except for the Colorado fans. So I got to see the cup get hoisted, like, right there, and, like, all the families walk out. It, to this day, it was the coolest thing I've probably ever seen live.
That's awesome.
I also remember telling my dad, like, well, we never have to talk about our problems ever again. We'll just have this. We don't have to be emotional with one another ever again. We can just be like, you remember that time we saw the Stanley Cup? And so far, that's been working.
Or if you guys ever get in an argument, you just put some of that glass in between you guys and you just then at least feel familiar, you know? Yeah.
What about you, Nick? Are you not really a big gift guy?
Well, you know, anytime I like travel or something, I'll usually get, I was in Canada recently, got my mother a moose bobblehead. How about that?
That's a good gift.
How about that? She appreciated it. She showed it to the waitresses we were at. Look what my son got me. I love it. And I was like, yeah, I fucking knew you would.
I'll get you a gift on this tour, Nicholas.
But, yeah, I'm trying to think if there's anything like spectacular. The problem is I've been broke for so long, so I've never gotten somebody like a car or something, you know. But no, I did have one of the as far as
that would be great to get someone like a shitty car, like a $300 car.
It's a car, man. Like,
what am I gonna do with this?
Go crash it into something, man. It was $300.
Yeah, I can't think of anything that would be like worth saying on a podcast.
You know, it's all right. We'll edit around.
Seem like the coolest guy ever, you know.
Well, any closing thoughts on the movie or anything for y'all head out?
Top five movie for sure.
It's so
American
great,
Psycho.
It's so great.
I think it's my favorite, like, dark comedy.
Yeah,
that's the thing. If you can just watch it as the comedy that it is hilarious. But I think people like take it serious when they watch it.
He just suddenly has a gun and it's a great marksman. Yeah, no, this part feels imagined to me.
Yeah, just bullseye in the heart right there. He definitely imagined all of this.
And then just the car exploding.
Oh, yeah, and the car explodes just from a bullet.
Oh, my favorite part is when he's running the hotel. He shoots like the concierge guy.
Oh yeah,
and he runs through like the revolving door and then comes back again and shoots another guy.
And there's no one anywhere. It's just abandoned everything.
Yeah, after having lived in New York, I will say there's always people.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's in the financial district at night. There are always people walking around.
That was great.
That's almost like the Indiana Jones where the guy does all the sword tricks and then he just pops him. You know?
Okay, here it comes. I love it. First shot, dude.
The janitor. What did he do, man? Come on.
Wrong place, wrong time, bro. The last note I was going to make on the movie is I read that Christian Bale had studied Tom Cruise. Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Trade after him.
You could totally see
Tom Cruise
doing this, too.
There was just like an intense lifelessness behind his eyes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, just dead behind the eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And he had done like a late night thing with him on Letterman or something when he met him and just said that like that was how he saw him. Oh, that was crazy too. Yeah, I saw too to get the role. He had to, like, the director didn't like him, and so he had a sit down dinner with him, and he went full Patrick Bateman during the dinner. And the director's just like, "This is so weird." Like, he's like, "Stop, please stop."
Yeah.
Like,
damn, dude.
Speaking of, when we were talking about Star Wars, Ewan McGregor was offered the role too, and
oh, I didn't know that.
He called him and was like, "Don't take this role," and he was like, "All right."
Who, Christian Bale?
Yeah, Christian Bale was like, please don't take this role.
He's like, I want to do this.
I imagine it like he's doing right now. Like, please don't take this role.
He's on the phone with him.
I ate their brains.
Yeah, he's confessing.
I even tried to cook a little.
Oh, man, we watched that in the car, man. It's so funny.
Here it is. And I killed Paul Allen. Paul Allen with an axe in the face. His body's dissolving in a bathtub in Hell's Kitchen.
Just bursting a blood vessel out of his forehead, screaming.
I guess he killed maybe 40. 20 people.
And then he's like, maybe 40. I don't know.
I have tapes of it.
The girls.
Is he returning the tapes to the video store if he's killing people?
I think so, right? Or no?
That's just what he says.
Or is that just what he...
Somebody.
When he just has to leave? Yeah, yeah.
It's just a perfect alibi.
You're right.
And it makes zero sense today. I gotta go to Redbox.
Yeah. Well, what if like a Gen Zer, that's the biggest problem they had with this movie? Return video? I don't understand. This is offensive.
Is he not streaming them?
Yeah, this movie's just not realistic. I don't understand.
Where is he going?
I would see right through that. Yeah. Like if you did say that today, I have to return some videotapes. This guy's a murderer. This guy's killing people. Blockbuster's dead, dude.
Well, I think we need to wrap it up. I got to return some videotapes.
So. Yeah, there it is. Thanks there for having us, fellas. Man,
thanks for being here, guys.
This is a good time. Till